tonight, eh? Dylan? Come on, you.
You're listening to the Doug Stanhope Podcast.
Anyway, now I'm reading this book about the history of Australia. Now I want to know more about. I know about Arthur the guy.
How much
what
do you
a
know?
Dick.
How much do you know about fucking American history?
Well, whatever you had to be taught, but not the. Graphic shit.
Okay,
I mean, yeah, everyone knows American history as far as like the you know, the awful parts. But this, I'm immersing myself in the awful parts of Australia. Everyone knows Australia was started as a prison colony, but this is like it's a 600-page book specifically dedicated to exactly what happened, where it happened, who did it. Who didn't do it? So, yeah, if I read American history...
Well, to name-check the book again.
Yeah, A Fatal Shore.
Robert
or
Hughes.
The Fatal Shore.
I did read about it because I had you two talking about it in the podcast yesterday.
Oh.
Yeah.
So who are you?
Maan. Oh.
Yes.
Maan.
Yeah. I was born in Kuwait.
All right, you got to eat the mic.
Eat the mic.
Yeah, just copy me.
Copy.
Keep your mouth right by the mic.
Right. So I was born in Kuwait, and then we lived in Iraq, and I was always asking questions.
Okay, let me back up, and I'm going to say this.
Go ahead.
As a warning.
Yeah.
Maan emailed me saying, I can't believe you're coming to Tasmania. That's sure. Where we are. And hey, who out there in the United States knows what continent Tasmania is on, much less what it's fucking near? He says, I can't believe you're coming. I don't want a thing. Very important. I just can't believe I'm going to see you. I was in a fucking Iraqi jail, and I'm an atheist, and I was facing 35 years. We're going to catch up on all these stories.
Yeah.
Don't want a thing, just glad I'm going to see you at the show.
Mm.
And I emailed him back saying, no, you're going to see me on a podcast because you got good. It's kind of a kick I've been on with foreign jails. First, Bangkok.
Also, very importantly, he also said in that email, don't worry, I have tickets for the show.
True that. Thank you for the backup.
Yeah,
appreciate
it. Yeah, but the number of times you get, I'm a really interesting guy, I don't have tickets.
Outspoken atheist. Now,
sure.
when you say you're born in Kuwait, just to give us a timeline, how old are you?
I'm 1985, so that's 33 years.
So Kuwait, that was, so you were born, still a kid when the first Iraq war.
The Iraqi-Iranian war, which started in 1980.
Were you still in Kuwait at that point?
We moved back to Iraq because of the Iraqi invasion to Kuwait in the 1990s. So.
You're just fucking ping-ponging away from trouble.
So we moved back, and then the whole... the American half invasion of Iraq is not even a full one back then. They backed for very different reasons between quotation marks. They were in really almost on the borders to Baghdad, and they backed for a reason or another. No one knows why. So the last war could have just been the last war, but something happened in the last operation that they didn't go all the way for
a
reason.
I don't want to. Yeah.
No, but that's just part of the history.
I don't have any idea. I was a young comic. Then.
Right.
I was when the first Iraqi war, I'm sure I had a couple of barbs, but I was 23. I didn't give a shit.
Yeah.
We're not with the Smithsonian, okay?
Yeah.
We're not going to fact check anything of what you're going to say. I think what we're interested in is going to ultimately be your personal story.
Yeah.
And something I just want to say, for the listeners and for everyone else, and I don't mean this in a condescending sense, but when we were coming in the hotel room just now, you said to us, I've only spoken English for how long?
8 years.
So how did you come to learn English?
I just think in English, you see. That's but the thing.
Something must have started that. Why did you have to learn English?
First of all,
he lives in fucking Tasmania.
No, before that, don't forget that the English speaking media is all through culture. So most of us in the East back then, we were very highly influenced by the Western English speaking, to be very exact, countries.
First of all, you know when black people start talking black, but they don't talk black, you vacillate between your English as a very English accent.
I've never been to England.
But then when you start talking about Iraq, you have a thick Iraqi accent.
Well, that's approved.
Everyone, rewind the podcast for 2 minutes and see if I, because within 2 minutes you went very Islam and then very English with no Australian whatsoever.
Right. I don't know. I just, my English.
How you
teacher,
going, mate?
No.
Fucking,
I don't
makes
do
me
that.
Sick.
I don't do that. I really don't do that.
Hennigan and I both.
Do you know the funny part?
It's just a how you going. No, it's how are you doing or how is it going? Not how you going.
My English teacher was Italian.
Ah.
I swear to God, that's not even a joke.
Hennigan taught English to Chinese people. And
Japanese people.
God help them.
Your name is Seamus. Anyway.
Right. Let me take this back over.
Please.
Let's get to the fun part.
Yeah, fun part.
Because, you sold me.
I was sent in jail in Iraq. I was actually kidnapped in Iraq by a gang. That they were representing.
Context.
Right.
How old are you?
I'm 33.
At the time.
At the time, 17.
17. 17. Where you're very boisterous.
Very, very. I was listening to Backstreet Boys and didn't even understand what it meant.
But this is the first. Was this all about atheism?
It was partially about atheism, but it was partially about. How open my family is about things as well. They know I'm an atheist. They know I'm pansexual as well. So they're quite a bit.
Hey, fucking, whoa. I only brought you here for a podcast.
Yeah.
To pitch in some spice. So all that they know. So the entire family was, although they're all Muslims, they're still in the shadows of the demon. But it's still.
Shadows of the demon.
but it's still, they're open-minded. And they accepted me, which is very supportive. But unfortunately, it's when the people take religion into their hands, not when the government. Most governments take religion as a facade just to satisfy their religious voters. But when it really comes to people taking religion in their hands, that's when it gets dirty and things get done, you see. So I was kidnapped by exactly that same gang.
Okay, in the detail, how were you kidnapped? What happened?
I left my house because I was just starting driving at that age back in Iraq. We do that, and I was going to uni, and I was trying to take a small shortcut, and I found a minibus that took me over. And just crossed in a small street, in a back street. They really crossed like
like a bank robbery.
Hollywood,
movie.
really. Yeah. It's the whole kind of back and blocking it. And I thought back then it was really about stealing cars. And I thought, oh, they're going to steal my car. Well, okay, give them. I really
stealing cars.
Stealing cars. So, and because I looked in the back and another car blocked the road as well.
Oh.
So I just took the keys out. A couple of guys walked out and with guns and get out, yelling and cursing and all that.
Hey,
and,
sorry.
Please.
I want to slow you down.
Sure.
So what year was this?
That was end of 2004. So that's November 2004.
It's after.
After, because that's the start of the whole gang and the whole militia kind of activity. Although.
This is Baghdad.
This is Baghdad, center of Baghdad, actually. And
so the war's already, that must have been
finished.
Going on.
That's finished. So you have the civil war.
Finished,
yeah. So 2004, when you have the civil war, that's the aftermath of the war, which is really caused the most casualties, even on you guys, the Americans. Cool.
See, you have to forgive my ignorance. I don't know that the war in Iraq is over. Is the one in Afghanistan over?
Oh, the ape shit. President of George Bush, didn't he just land on the carrier and said, well, the war is over.
Mission accomplished.
Mission accomplished. Yes, there you go. So
I understand that, but we were still at a presence and
plenty.
People
and
were still dying for...
Absolutely.
Up until today, as far as I know, because... The
and
real
no
mission accomplished
it.
Was, yeah. I don't know, it was, all right,
it was,
go
yeah,
ahead.
It was just
but,
like, oh.
So there's still a U.S. military occupancy.
Absolutely, absolutely.
All right, so it's still going on.
It's still going on, still going on.
And still, they're still worried, the people that pull up and kidnap you, they're worried about your atheism or your bisexuality or both
no,
at the same time.
No, they didn't know about my sexuality. If they knew about my sexuality, things would have been
very different. Oh, you could have sucked your dick out of it.
I'll
suck dick out of it.
But you were basically saying, here's my car keys.
Yeah, really. And they were like, no, where are you going? Go back to the back of the minibus.
Oh,
that's what I knew. Uh-oh.
How did these people know about your
They do their research. Don't forget that. They do their real research. I mean, most of these guys actually come from the dissolved army. So these guys got professional training of being military officers, being intelligent agents, and all that.
But how do they know about your atheism? Are you online?
No. I'm just talk to friends.
In the street?
In the street, talks. Oh. Yeah. So I talk to friends. I always argue. We sit in big cafes. People listen and they get sucked in and, you know, and people get very, very touchy when it comes to that part of their lives. Sadly, which is nonsensical in my opinion. But my experience changed. The way I see the universe has changed. There were... It's just very different when you're freed from that social grip on you as well of not leaving.
Did you learn atheism through your parents or just...
No,
your
since own? I was young. Since I was young, I was asking the question why the immovable mover has these immovable movers kind of qualities. Why there is a God and if there is someone caused everything, why he doesn't have a cause? I was always asked, always answered that there are questions that we can't ask, and it's blasphemy. It's a blasphemy to ask a question. But hey, if it's blasphemous, why would God insert that question in my head to start with? So
did you get a lot of pussy with these?
I did when I was young. I was a DJ in Dubai. I was just. So I was
when
doing
when
my
you're
thing.
17, are you like spouting off because
no,
they
not
think
in Iraq. Pussy you're in Iraq? Cool. What? No, everything's locked, man.
But I'm being somewhat facetious.
Yeah,
but
right.
As a 17-year-old, you would have to have a reason to be promoting. Did it make you cool on some level to be like a? I would equate it to being a fan of punk rock when everyone else is into new wave. Like, did it kind of make you stand out? Was there a reason?
No, because I was really just compassionate to blind beliefs and missing something so majestic like the universe. And all's even in I'm an atheist, I witness all's and beauties and all that. And I think religion just puts such a dark veil on that. And you can't see through. So your communication with others are different. Our social structure is very different. And I 100% agree with you that no kids, bad timing. Absolutely.
Okay, so you gained a reputation like a beat poet talking atheism at a coffee shop. And then the next thing you know, get stopped in the street and they kidnap you.
Even further, actually, they were planning to kidnap my sister to shame my entire family. You see, that's the thing. So, but they didn't catch at that time.
What,
so
you knew about that plot?
No. They told me when they kidnapped me.
Oh,
so
like,
I stayed.
We got you because we couldn't get her.
Yeah, that's right. So I was the second. No. They were trying to harm me.
All right. So now you're kidnapped.
Mm.
I assume a hood over your head or.
I'm talking.
Don't worry, everyone listening is painting a picture.
Spa, beautiful spa. I mean, massages beautifully. Yeah. Actually, they actually put a tire, a car tire, so I can't move because I was put.
A what?
A car tire, you know.
Oh, a car. Yeah, oh, like necklacing.
Exactly. Yeah. Really, they did it properly. And one guy just came. They stopped somewhere. That's in the pursuit to whatever I was being led. And one guy stopped because my phone was ringing. People were calling me. They heard about it. And I had a siren ringtone and they were going apeshit. Thinking, I swear, they think it's a police. And someone stopped.
You have a police siren as a ringtone.
It was an old phone too, you see. So that one of the sirens for the messages. And when I stopped, can you shut this fucking phone up? And he punched me in my face too. It was like, well,
that would be very annoying. So I can understand that.
I know, isn't it?
Listen, if you were on a plane next to me and your siren kept going off.
What a dick.
I would have a plane show up in front and behind my plane, kidnap you, and then punch you in the face.
Oh, that's it.
All right, so where did they take you?
So they took me to an under construction site. So that's where they kept me. But the story gets a bit funnier in the middle.
It's hilarious.
It really is. Really is. So one of the times, really, I was so blindfolded. Okay, and that was a good insurance actually to me, because when you see them, that's the sign of they're gonna kill you because you've seen them, and it's an actual thing going on in that part of the world. But anyways,
oh, you can't do what we do and say, "Hey, you all look the same to me."
Abdul, did you take me on a new bus ride
tonight, listeners? Well, as you sit there at your glum job listening, saying, "Oh, my life sucks. I listen to podcasts." He emailed me, then sat in the front row, and I walked out and immediately went, "Hey, are you my guy?" He goes, "Yeah, yeah."
True.
But if there were two Iraqis there, or Iranians, whatever the fuck,
yep,
I'd have to go, which one of you is my guy?
Make sure one with no button. You're calling the wrong guy.
I did fuck up your country of origin. But again, I only saw the email.
Yeah.
You're at a construction site.
Right. So
you're waiting to die?
No, that's what they're going to take, blackmailing the parents.
Oh, so it's like a kidnapping.
It's a kidnapping. Yeah, kidnap, really. So they asked for $500,000 to release me. My dad laughed at them. Really? He's like, what the fuck do you want me to bring you $500,000 in this economy and me being my dad? So they kept torturing me and calling my mother and
torturing you.
Torturing you.
Yeah, we have to ask, what do you call torture?
So beating up. And there is one very specific day that I keep laughing for the rest of my life about. The funny part is the blindfold was actually see-through. I couldn't see faces, but I can recognize figures. Right, here's the case. One day in the morning, really, some fat fuck just walks into the room and is starting beating the shit out of me, senseless. And I'm just screaming, why? And the guy said, why do you eat chicken and I eat falafel, which is the whole fried vegetable kind of poor food. I really looked at him and was like, if I eat chicken and you eat falafel, how the fuck are you fatter than me? He went, since I lost my mind. No, because you got at that level. How the fuck do you want to deal with
you this? Actually said
I
that.
I swear to you, I said that. I mean, it's just amazing how someone gets to a point where total meltdown. Doesn't matter what happened anymore. Doesn't matter. But I was sold to another gang, and that's the best part.
Say that again.
Wait. I was sold to another gang because the first gang.
You have to explain gangs.
Right. Militias. Religious militias.
Okay. All right.
We call them gangs because they're gangs. They just do what the gang does. Right. Just they have their religion up
for
front.
My listeners, right. They're going to go,
okay,
what?
Fair enough, yeah.
Bloods and Crips?
They sell of some sort, but they have atheism. Allah behind them.
So basically, the first gang kind of felt, oh, shit.
We're
getting nowhere with this.
We struck wrong, yeah.
And you were traded.
Traded for another gang. a cheaper one, actually. They kept me at a rooftop where actual pigeons live. So they definitely didn't have the money for a construction site.
So, and but the whole aim always was to get money from your parents.
I have no idea, really. I think that changed because of first gang sold me to another gang. That's changed, I think, the motive a bit. Because the second gang...
that kidnapped you.
Yeah.
Were asking your parents for $500,000.
$500,000 to kill me. Yeah, absolutely.
And how long did that last?
11 days. 11 days, to be exact. But in between, I was sold to another gang in 5 days, and... the transportation.
Oh, wait. So 5 days.
Five days in, I was sold to another gang.
Your dad made sure they knew.
There's no point. He's not worth $500,000.
Yeah, your dad was all fucking all the money in the world.
Yeah,
John Paul Getty.
I can make another one. Right.
Don't worry. You hang around that kid long enough, you're going to be paying me to take him back.
So what happened is the second gang was actually a very poor one to be. They kept me on the rooftop with the pigeons and they were feeding me for 2 days. And then they were not going anywhere with my parents. And then when the torture came back. Okay.
More torture.
Yeah, because what they do, they torture you and they call whoever cares.
Oh, I see.
Did you see it?
Listen to this.
Listen to this.
Ow!
Like that.
That tickles. Yeah. Ow!
Don't touch my ass.
James Inman's marketing strategy.
My aunt is actually an American, been living in the States for the past 40 years, and all my cousins are fully Americans. They don't even speak Arabic. So
can you do an American accent?
I can't, because that's not how I think.
Neither can I.
I'm just smarter.
Inside joke. Hennigan can do one, but he won't do it unless he has to get out of a kidnapping.
If you kidnap me. if a ruthless gang... kidnapped.
Go ahead.
So they closed down on the 10th day that my dad agreed to pay $10,000, and obviously that's what I'm worth in his eyes.
By the way, I just want to say, your dad, solid negotiation skills from $500,000 to $10,000.
I swear.
That is commendable. That is as good as the deal I once did actually, with the San Jose Improv.
The shout-out is actually for my uncle. My uncle, who was carrying the negotiations.
Fantastic.
And he just probably didn't give a shit.
10 days. We want $500,000. Okay, we'll take $10,000.
We don't need this atheist right. Fuck in the family.
So does your father brag about that ever?
No, because I swear to you, and I'm not even exaggerating for a bit, my dad got kidnapped 3 times. My dad in Iraq got kidnapped 3 times.
Why is he on the
before podcast? Or after? Before or after that?
After. So I was the starter. I was just the. Really, he got kidnapped 3 times, and he's a Muslim.
How much did you pay for him?
No, he paid for himself.
I'm sure the ATM opened up for him.
Dad, you paid $10,000 for me. I'm paying $2,000 for you. but now it was for my dad. It was mostly financial extortion, not of a religious or hatred based. No, but generally he got kidnapped 3 times in Iraq, and we dealt with it quite successfully. Being my mother from the Middle East, but
that must be very inconvenient.
Quite a bit. 3 times that. Fucking learn your lesson. Move.
Well,
the
you
fuck
were
out
an
there.
Adult. You didn't need your dad anymore.
No, but in the Middle East, we have a very tight obligations to the family members, not like in the West. Although I agree with the West. I think it's a bit more convenient just to forget about your parents.
Dispatch them.
6 years of no expectations whatsoever. Leave me alone. But no, in the Middle East, it's a bit different. So you're hardwired into cultural construct,
so
too.
Can you... I mean, did you eventually leave Iraq? And can
my
you,
dad, wait, actually, wait, sorry.
Did you eventually leave Iraq? And are you? Can you? Could you go back there?
Right. My dad, after he paid $10,000, he said, "No, you're less expensive outside Iraq." So he sent us to Dubai, and that's where I actually didn't keep my mouth shut.
Okay, so now you're an adult.
Mm.
You're a
20s.
Okay,
20.
20 years old.
Dubai.
Sent to Dubai.
Right.
Which
right.
I just like my fucking ongoing Thailand thing, which I'm just going to make worse. For that same reason, I do these crazy flights to mileage runs, they call them. At the end of the year, if I'm not diamond status on Delta, I fly anywhere I can, long distance. One of the longest ones, you can go through Dubai, which I will not go through because I have talked shit about every religion. And I don't want to be one of those guys that, oh, you've blasphemed, we're fucking locking you up.
But locking up's not the problem anymore. It's just...
It is for me.
No, no, but you have even deeper problems. Like being executed. That's a deeper problem than being in prison. So it is that ridiculous place when the government tries to judge a couple of atheists just to make a lesson. We are doing something about it. See, in the Middle East, and especially in Iraq, right now, in Iran as well, in Afghanistan, I think it's an American touch, but what happens is atheism becomes in people's heads as a campaign against their fundamental beliefs in life. Okay, and when someone touches that part of your life, it's a bit sensitive to everyone. It doesn't matter, even if you're an atheist, when someone tries to challenge your atheism by probably a bit of thinkable material, you start being a bit sensitive. But fundamentalism is a completely different issue. That's when they really take vengeance by their hands, and that's a very serious thing. This is the way it is. I think is just how you say it. Lack of bravery from most people in the Middle East because they've been pounded by a lot of wars. Really, that's what it is. So they didn't have the time to recover and probably just think like their ancestors did. The Babylonians were very philosophically, let's say, advanced to their times back then. But now, the same people who lives after them, they don't. The reason being is that part of the world is just so devastated by wars and, I think, natural resources, a.k.a. oil.
I used to do a bit about like how they're that fundamental because they don't have the distractions that we do. The Christianity that you have in the United States is, oh, yeah, well, we dismiss all these. Okay, yeah, that's in the Bible, but we dismiss those because, oh, life's really fun with those. Yeah. But we still focus on this shit. And the old bit was if we just dropped our old distractions, our old Atari video games that we don't use because we use new video games and got everyone as apathetic and bored rather than just throwing fucking dirt clods at each other. I don't know how much of that is accurate, but I prejudge cultures very well. I know when I go to this country that I've never been to, it's going to be like this. I can tell from the fucking pictures. I can't see anything fun in the Middle East. It's a fucking...
Besides Beirut.
What's that?
Go party in Beirut, Lebanon. You want to party? Go to Beirut.
But it's still...
Oh, you see? I hear nudges. It's still nudges
a clay fucking awful...
No. Go party in Beirut. Really?
All right. Well, Beirut was never really in...
And do a gig in Beirut.
I mean, listen, you can...
I know. I was waiting.
I'll never fucking go to a Muslim country ever.
You can actually manage to do a gig in Beirut, and you'll be safe if you manage it properly. There's so much skepticism in there. It's not even funny. I mean, you'll find Muslim women actually wearing hijab and... drinking booze.
Bear in mind, you do have the track, I Hate the Jews.
Yeah. Hey!
You could be carried along the streets of Beirut.
Bonus points.
Yeah, I claim to love the desert, and I live in one, but not that desert. It just seems like so awful.
Are you scared of the camel fucking?
And I can't imagine.
Are you scared of the camel fucking?
So, what was the actual issue with you and the atheism? Sure. Were you actually prosecuted or arrested specifically for
this
that?
He hasn't got to Dubai yet. Oh, no, you're a color man, Brian. You make the jokes. I'll guide the...
Hang on, let's take a quick break and... Blue Apron. The whole block's eating Blue Apron. Everyone's eating Blue Apron around here. Sent right to your door. Blue Apron is the leading meal kit delivery service in the U.S. because of our advertisements. Advertisements? How do you say it, Jonathan? Advertisements.
Advertisement.
Advertisement. No, it's our fucking cool ads. It's cool. Our cool ads and our listeners keep Blue Apron the number one meal kit delivery service in the U.S. And while many people know what we do, not us, Blue Apron. We here, I guess we are Blue Apron family.
We are Blue Apron.
Yeah, we should get some fucking swag. Hey, I eat Blue Apron. I sell Blue Apron. I am Blue Apron. That's a fuck. Hey, pitch that around the PR people. See if that sells.
Blue Apron tattoos. It's going to go viral.
Temporary tattoos, like Ooh. Bingo's temporary tattoos. I'd get a Blue Apron tattoo as my first tattoo on my face. A lot of people don't know the types of meals you eat when you cook with Blue Apron. You're not just having burgers for dinner. You're making short rib burgers with a what? A hoppy cheddar sauce? Hoppy? Is that like opium?
It's like a hoppy Easter.
I'm all hopped up on Blue Apron. I can't get enough. I'm snorting Blue Apron, then I go to needles. I swore I'd never use needles because, the hoppy sauce on a pretzel bun. You're crazy, Blue Apron. I thought I was going to make junk in a bucket, but instead I got seared steaks and thyme pan sauce with mashed potatoes, green beans, and crispy shallots. Nothing worse than a soggy shallot. I will never eat another soggy shallot. They bring them to me crispy all in under 45 minutes and without a trip to the grocery store. You know why I hate grocery stores? I hate tripping all over those fucking stumble bums looking for razors. Okay. General Blue Apron facts. These are just general facts. You can find these on Wikipedia, but who's going to sell them to you with this kind of gusto?
Don't check them on Snopes, whatever you do.
Blue Apron is the number one fresh ingredient and recipe delivery service in the country. You don't want to go with number two, because number two means poop.
Who eats number two? Come on.
Some people, but you just laugh at the videos. Okay. Blue Apron offers three plans. The two-person meal plan. That's a meal that serves two people. The family.
Wait, what?
Yeah. They got this shit worked out. They have this, like, the fact that you're not paying for their accountants to get these good deals. There's the family meal plan. That serves four people. What is this, 1950? A family could be... Jesus, look at, none of us are related, and there's eight of us here. Then there's the wine plan. I would assume, because I would go with the wine plan. If there's a two-person plan, a four-person family plan, I would assume the wine plan is for the solo guy alone that doesn't really eat.
As a fat guy, I would go with the four-person plan. Plus wine, because even if I don't like the wine, if somebody brings it to my door, I'm drinking that
shit. You'd give them your own name for the four-person, and then you'd have some nom de plume for the wine, like, oh, that's someone else that lives here in this storage shed. You can't live in a storage shed. We're not even supposed to deliver to a storage shed. I'm just drinking wine, and the other four people will be here to... Blue Apron is the leading meal kit delivery service in the U.S. Act like you've been there before, Blue Apron. Don't keep making me say you're number one. You got a three-peat.
Blue Apron is treating the Doug Stanhope podcast listeners to $30 off your first order if you visit blueapron.com/Stanhope. So check out this week's menu and get your $30 off at blueapron.com/Stanhope. Blue Apron. A better way to cook.
Hey, we're back.
The Dubai part is when I was introduced to a much lenient, because Dubai is Dubai, being trying to live up to modern societies, living up to metropolitan kind of city structures and all that. So they couldn't afford being as fundamentalist as Iraq is, okay? So Dubai, you see Dubai, beautiful place from the outside, from the inside a bit rotten, like almost in every place.
Yeah, we know about their immigration.
Right, yeah, exactly. That's another issue.
Oh, no, we trucked the Indians fucking outside of town and put them in barracks.
I posted something on Facebook the other day. They started a new space agency trying to send men to Mars. And I said, are they going to use the slavery East Asians and there to pick the first Emirati rocket man and throw him to space? A lot of Emiratis I have on my friend list didn't like it. I was hoping they would. They didn't.
What was the word you're using there? Emirati? Yeah.
Emirati is the local of the United Arab Emirates.
Emirati.
So, yes, the United Arab Emirates is the country. Dubai is the financial capital, while Abu Dhabi is the, you can say, the formal capital of it. Nice people, beautiful place, but a lot of hypocrisy in there.
It's kind of like Las Vegas in the mob years, where you go, hey, yeah, caught you counting cards. Yeah. We're going to smash your knuckles with a ball peen hammer. No one's going to see it. Everyone's going to eat shrimp cocktail on the cheap, and you're going to be going, ow, ow, my fingers.
You'll find a lot of people driving Range Rovers of the latest model, and they don't have money in their pockets or credit cards to fill the fucking thing to drive it. So it's very pretentious there. So they don't have real money, but they have the marketing and all the other countries around it, like Saudi, where the money is. They don't have the prostitution the UAE has, so you'll find a flux.
So it is like Vegas.
It is like Vegas. It is like Vegas. It's never been there, but I think it would be.
But I'm saying they have gambling and legalized prostitution in a desert that no one would go to without gambling and prostitution.
So the government
bright lights, big city.
So the government itself, they solicit the prostitution. Well, they keep another cheek for it. They don't turn the other eye. But it truly, you find them introducing religious.
That's what I was kind of getting to, is the fact that, using my dumb, illogical point of view, that they're Saudi Arabia, Dubai, they do have money. They do have the distractions, yet they still believe in this bullshit. So it kind of canceled my idea that they're just bored, dirt clawed people that believe in this for no reason. They have the distractions, yet they still prop up this, you know, Muslim facade.
So in Saudi Arabia, they do have the money because they do have the oil.
Yeah.
United Arab Emirates run out of oil for probably 5-10 years now. So they're using the marketing and the Dubai picture to promote marketing, business, and other stuff that you don't see as well, like probably money laundering by a lot of organizations as well. The issue with Saudi Arabia. I don't want to get a bit philosophical about it, but in Buddhism, they say we all have a void that we try to fill. Some people need religion. Some people need comedy. Some people need a fist. Maybe pull some in a fist. Okay. I don't think the fist can fill a void. I think two can. But it depends on your preferences. In saying that, you always will have that part of society that tries to attach itself to something probably that's not real, because reality itself is very vague in answers to fundamental things. I didn't tell you, by the way, I tried to finish my PhD in theoretical physics, and I'm a philosopher as well.
Okay, I'm leaving.
Yes, I tried to do a lot of studies. My atheism actually came from physics. I was obsessed with physics since I was very, very young. And I did my...
Yeah, all right. Yeah, kill that. My listeners just tuned out at physics.
And I'm mostly interested in the philosophy of quantum mechanics.
So are we.
every good comedy podcast is really overwhelmed with quantum physics.
Now leave that, but I'm just
prison time, Dubai. Yeah. What happens? You're still a smart mouth, wise ass Dennis the Menace in fucking Dubai.
Right.
Your dad got you out of there. He's still fucking hog tied and roped in the trunk of an Alfa Romeo. And no one's bailing him out. Where's my bailout? Says your dad. I gave $10,000 to bail you out. Where's my bailout? And you're over talking shit in some tower in Dubai.
So we
and
they're moved.
Going, we're going to make it taller. And you're like, no, there's no such thing as Muhammad. Muhammad is a fucking disaster waiting to happen.
No, so we moved out of, my dad got kidnapped 3 times when he realized, well, this place is not a place to grow children up.
Learner.
Exactly.
I'm getting to your
my situation in Dubai.
35-year prison sentence in Dubai.
So what happened when I was in Dubai and I faced a different leniency, rather than just being kidnapped, you'll just probably slapped on the wrist. So I opened my mouth even further. And I was introduced to alcohol there. Okay, so that's so what I picked.
So here you are with
new...
a bottle of Cristal, a boner, and a tunic.
It was absolute for me, or absinthe, really. I was just hitting it hard at that. But anyways, that's been said. So alcohol gets you.
For the listener, there was just a recent story where a Westerner of some kind was jailed in Dubai for brushing against another dude's ass. Now, he said, I was just trying to squeeze through a fucking bar, but they saw it as a homosexual advance. And that guy was facing, I forget, Google it. I don't know what consulate had to fucking finally, after weeks or months, get him freed. That shit happens. So
it does. No, not only that, I actually know my best friend in Dubai. His cousin came from the UK to do a DJ gig in Dubai. And honestly speaking, that's what I've been told. So I'm just re-quoting it here. He was smoking a joint in Heathrow before he got in, and he just stepped on it. Okay, and obviously some of it stuck to his shoe, and the dog in the government the airport in Dubai, they picked him up at 4 years in jail. 4 years in jail. He didn't have anything on him. It was stuck up his shoes. He could have just walking by someone who just threw it by and just step on it, and here we go. So
it's I think this is my last international tour because. At home, it's the devil you know. It's fucked up.
Right.
So you're back to smart mouthing on absolute.
Absolutely.
Whipping liquor bottles at nuns.
And getting into very long.
Muslim nuns.
Yeah. Oh, they don't get to bars, sadly. I think they don't drink. Muslim nuns don't. Muslim imams do. Man-made stuff. Anyways, so usually in pubs, when you drink quite a bit as well, you get quite motivated to sound the truth. So in a lot of pubs, when you find a lot of CID, which is the secret police in every single pub in Dubai, you'll find absolutely CID there. Without a single doubt, you'll be a daft bastard if you skip that.
Wait, hang on, slow down. The CID is like the...
The secret police. The secret police.
We had that in China where they were telling us, oh, no, we had the higher up, like, secret police watching my show that would throw out the lesser than police that might have shut your show down. Like, they had it sussed out where, oh, we get the FBI. In case a local cop show up, we got fucking FBI on the payroll. So if they don't like what you're saying, they'll tell them to fuck off.
But they do collect a lot of information there because that's how you keep everything tight. You know everything about everyone.
So it sounds like, I mean, the situation is basically that they collect information on everyone, and they have information on everyone, and then they just decide one day, oh, if we decide to go for you, we've got the information we need.
I need to add one this bit. Back then when I was young, I was listening to black metal, so I was quite a black metal head, and I had a band logo called Dark Funeral from Sweden. Which
Dark
is a
Funeral.
Dark Funeral.
Oh, Dark
so,
Funeral.
So the logo is a pentacle upside down and two crosses upside down, and I just wanted to add a bit on the bottom, Satan, just for the fun of it. So a lot of people actually complained about the car, and then I was called by the police headquarters. Excuse me, can you bring your car here? There is a bit of questioning about it. And I thought I was, because the tinting was a bit too dark.
Oh, okay. Mm. You haven't learned your lesson where...
No.
Okay, this car screeches in front of me. Right. Another car screeches in back of me. Now I'm a kidnapped victim for 11 days. Next thing you know, you're in Dubai and you don't question, hey, why don't you come down with your Satan mobile? We just want to look at your tinting.
Yeah. Well, I didn't learn my lesson. I really
you thought
turn it
yourself
was...
in a lot unknowingly.
Yeah, probably. So I parked outside the headquarters and
probably double parked and didn't pay the meter.
Actually, I did double park. I'm not even joking. I walked inside and I was like, yeah, what's going on? So I'm the owner of this car. I was like, yeah, please bring it in. We would like to see it. So I actually drove it into the headquarters, which was fenced. And I found a myriad of officers just waiting for me. Some of them are actually bearded much more than my beard. So of the religious type. And I was like, oh, fuck. I knew what was going to happen. I just looked in the mirror and I saw that.
That's the point you went, oh, fuck.
Oh,
no, yeah. That's the point he called mom and said, mom, yeah, pay dad's kidnappers because this one's going to cost him so much more.
And because it was really large, it was on the back of.
I'm sorry.
Back of.
Oh, sorry. Were you doing a podcast when you put the mic?
I did. So the back window of the car was that logo was quite large. So one of the the senior officers came like, so what is this? What does it mean? He was quite inquisitive and trying to be polite. I was like, it's just a band logo. I was like, so why does it have this cross upside down and this pentacle, which is quite satanic? I was like, well, this is their logo, just like some of your football teams, they have logos, they have a logo too. I was like, so what does this Satan means? Pronounce it properly. He's like, I was like, it's Satan. He was like, so what does it mean? He's like, Satan. And he was like, yeah, in Arabic, I was like, devil in translation. Okay. And he was like, why would you have this on your car? It's a very bad thing. You come from Iraq, you speak Arabic. Aren't you a Muslim? No. Are you a Christian? Why would you have something upside down? I'm not a Christian too. I think that's when it clicked in their head. They were like, okay, you have to leave your car with us for a month at least. It's impounded immediately. And we'll contact you soon. That's when actually the police got into contact with me because one of the officers actually, I think he was very kind. He was like, man, just take it off, strip it off because they're trying to put a case on you. That's 35 years in jail, if it's not at least 50. Okay. So rip it off. And oh no, I said no, because that I really was.
You're
strong
fucking
I know.
Dumb as shit.
I know. Not dumb, probably idealist. You see?
Yeah.
Yeah, but dumb in some sense.
Yeah, maybe you're early 20s, but still, no.
An idealist, quite a bit, yeah. Yeah. My dad was quite a bit upset about it. He thought it was against free speech and free freedom in general, although he knew what it meant.
Yeah, your dad was fucking hogtied in the back of a taxi. So
anything
what
would have been good.
Who gives a shit about his opinion? Like, at what point did you make the decent decision to be thrown into exile on the island of Tasmania? Rather than keep fucking up by trying to teach fucking morons that they're morons.
I never actually offended anyone's belief, besides at the end of thing when you don't can't explain anything. Tell them to fuck off. You just can't help it. Besides that, I always just trying to present certain arguments, and I was expecting someone of that belief to understand that question.
But it sounds almost like you're presented with multiple. It doesn't sound like these people that were calling you into the courtyard with your car were like the Pharisees and the Zealots. They're guys who are basically going, okay, what's up with this? And they're giving you multiple outs.
Yeah.
And you're going, no, hand me the spade. Because I'm going to keep digging.
This is basically the bit I did about just move.
Yeah.
If you live in fucking Utah and you're tired of Mormons, you can just move. You finally moved here to Tasmania where all they worship are sheep and fucking cold, clammy
climates.
Yeah, pneumonia type of climate. If all those people that believe that shit could just live in one place and had no one to hate, then they would actually grow. If there was no other person to hate, and if all of us lived in one place, there was no one to hate, I'd be out of business. But it would be a happier world.
Would it be because when they grow, they're going to grow closer to your land, and you're going to clash with them?
Well, that's the problem with everything. All right, this is how we close this podcast, because this is how Chad Shank and I, and anyone of any fucking rational train of thought ends every. Yeah, if we all lived like this in our own peaceful communities, you'd keep fucking and making more people until we were border to border and there would be no desert or underground. Yeah, you keep fucking, you keep making people, eventually they're going to have to co-mingle. Yeah, if we separate all the beliefs, you're going to keep making fucking children and spreading your beliefs.
Can I ask you a question?
What? Please.
I still don't actually understand how you're in Tasmania.
Right. So because I have an undergraduate degree in computer science and I specialize in software engineering, so I skilled migrated to Australia and I started finishing my PhD in theoretical physics in Wollongong, and I just moved down to Hobart actually 3 months ago. So I'm quite a newbie down here.
Oh.
So they threw you out of...
No, I left without them trying to fist fuck me, to be very frank with you.
That was from Wollongong.
No. Wollongong is nice.
All right.
Dubai is not as nice.
All right. I thank you, Mon.
Yeah, that's it, this man. So
no. We can Google you online and we'll see like a younger, healthier are Stanley still, Tucci.
Are you still... I was going with... I still can't come up with the easy name.
Oh.
Fucking... what's his name? Been thinking the whole time. Oh, fucking... The Diali G. Sasha Baron Cohen.
Oh! No. Oh, my. I think he'll want to go with the fucking Stanley Tucci. Even if he's Stanley Tucci is a bit shorter.
A bit shorter. Yeah.
And a lot older.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, welcome to Tasmania. Yeah. Welcome to freedom.
Yeah, after Wollongong, it must be tough.
Well, welcome to Hobart, really, and really amazing show. I laughed my tits off. It was really, really funny.
It was a show. I said some stuff.
Oh, come on. That was the first time I'm seeing you. Don't make it worse.
Yeah, wait, sir, it's another question. What? How do you know about Doug?
Honestly, I internet, of course.
But okay. When?
When? Oh.
God, how far back?
2005?
Wow. So where were you then?
Dubai.
Wiping gunpowder off the back of his head.
After a car bomb.
So 2005?
Yeah.
In Dubai?
In Dubai, because you were listening. We had the internet.
So you were listening to Doug Stanhope?
Yeah, really. Yeah, so yeah.
That would have been Deadbeat Hero days.
No, it wasn't. Was it out then? 2005?
Four, yeah.
Four. So this is awesome. Yeah, I've been listening to him. And and really good that he's not dead as Carlin. That would be a disaster. We all need some punch of truth somewhere.
What's your next plan? Are you still writing atheist tomes on some kind of chumster, as Henry Phillips would say?
I was planning to write a book about atheism, but my mother, I had my mother in consideration and my parents because they'll be
concentration camp?
No, concentration, in consideration not to write it. I was going to write a book called On a Mission to Kill God. Really, just to ridiculously dissolve this absolutely nonsensical belief of precursor. The precursor is just ridiculous, but anyways, it's biologically hardwired in our heads. In saying that, I knew my parents will be the aftermath of the retaliation to whatever provocative book would be.
So are they in Guantanamo now or soon?
But my parents, they have quite a bit of a social network that they'll be disconnected from because of their son wrote something of that disrespect.
They're going to shut off their MySpace.
It sounds like you just move from place to place, finding whatever offends the locals, but in a non-profitable way, like we do with Doug. And like, so haven't you just set about finding out what pisses off Tasmanian people and then declared yourself against it? And you're not like doing wheelies outside Tasmanian police force with a fucking sheep saying this sucks?
No, they're quite relaxed here.
Fuck mutton. Fuck mutton. I mean, not literally. I'm saying fucking mutton.
Mutton is a disgraceful meat.
Well, everyone needs a hobby. I think that'll be.
By the way, some
polyester killed wool for a reason.
On which point, they gave me a fucking shot of Tasmanian whiskey.
Is that why you're being such a dick tonight?
It was grotesquely awful. I mean, I will drink all sorts of whiskey from all over the world, but the fucking Tasmanian whiskey was awful.
Let me close this podcast by shitting on that place I ate at twice today.
Oh, the hog's breath.
The hog's breath.
Oh, did you?
Maybe
you
we ate could do an advert for
twice.
Them.
It's my fault. I'm lazy. And, it's right there.
And you blame me for not learning lessons?
Unbelievable. Oh, it was.
Are you looking for biofuel diarrhea?
It is. You have a black fingernail.
Yeah, it's not like a black eye. That's
like different. not like painted black.
Yeah,
like
it's not fucking.
No.
I thought that's, is that torture? Are they still torturing you and you can't talk?
No, that's just a window thing. Sorry for not providing that.
I'm gonna go smoke on Alex's balcony.
Yeah.
Mont.
Shit out and vomit the hog's breath. Food.
All right. Alex, thank you. Mon.
Doc, thank you.
Thank you for sharing your. I know we're gonna have more from you because you're gonna keep fucking up. You're only 33. I didn't stop fucking up till my late 40s.
Yeah, I think everyone needs that. Really.
Brian Hennigan, thank you for sitting here drunk on Tasmanian whiskey. And
it was awful. I like
Tasmania.
I like it as well. I haven't seen one of the devil things, which I'm sure must be a common complaint.
Yeah,
they have the only cancer that's contagious.
What?
They have the only cancer that's contagious. Well, to other devils.
The only what?
Cancer.
That's contagious to other devils.
Contagious
not
cancer.
Not to us.
Oh. But can you fuck them?
If you're in a ute, you can.
Click. Did you hang up? No, I just said click.